Hello again, Mr. Tarrou. We're going to continue our conversation today with what I started in the notes the other yesterday with statistics, which is describing or analyzing graphs. And we finished off with shape, center, spread, and outliers. When you describe a distribution, histogram, stem plot, or dot plot, you want to include those four statistics in your discussion. I want to continue with what I said the other day, which was we have measures of spread that we use quite often. Besides what I've already talked about, another measure of spread besides range and IQR is standard deviation. This is by far the most commonly used measure of spread in statistics. But before I keep rambling on, let me pause for just a second and get out of your way so you can copy these down. Okay, so hopefully it paused and copied that if you'd like an organized set of notes, if you don't already have some from your teacher. Now, standard deviation, what is it? Standard deviation is the average distance each piece of data is from the mean or from the mean, from the center of a bell curve distribution or the mean. The standard deviation is not a good measure of spread to use unless you are looking at a bell curve distribution. If your histogram, you don't know what normal means yet, but if your histogram has one mound in the middle, one mode in the middle, it's unimodal, and it's symmetric, then we will be discussing later how that is normal, or it could be normal. But for right now, we're just getting the basics down. So standard deviation is the average distance each piece of data is from the mean. We are going to really delve into this in the next section of the book, or in a later video. So we'll be talking about doing an example with formulas and showing you exactly some data points and calculating standard deviation and showing you really how they are measured from the mean, which is one of the three measures of center of a distribution. It is not a resistant measure. I'm throwing a lot of vocab out here, and unfortunately there's a lot of vocab to take care of in statistics. I'm kind of pulling concepts from the first two sections of my textbook together, so a lot of this vocab you're going to hear again in the following videos, and I'll really revisit this, and I'm just going to say resistant, I'll verbally say it now, but it will not be defined firmly with a written definition and an example until a later video. But a resistant measure is if you have some values like 6, 7, 8, 10, 10, 6, 5, just some random numbers, or they represent data. If you have an outlier that gets introduced, it will greatly affect the standard deviation. It'll change a lot. So if I give you a group of numbers, maybe the standard deviation is 2, and to those numbers I include a very large outlier. That outlier, even though it's only maybe one number, if far away from the original group of numbers, will greatly increase the standard deviation to where it's not really representing the spread of the data anymore. So standard deviation is not resistant. And it is not resistant because the mean is used in its calculation and the mean is not resistant. Again, all these vocab words will be re-explained further in a later video. Standard deviation, okay, we have two symbols for standard deviation. We have S of X and sigma of X. S of X is what we're going to calculate with our graphing calculator. So if you have an 83, 84, and a TI Inspire, you are going to be using S of X out of that calculator when you do one bar stats. We will be given on using this math symbol of sigma of X, but sigma of X is standard deviation of a population. And when you're in a textbook and you do an intro to statistics, we will never be using the entire population. So we will be given this value, this symbol, but we will never compute it. We are never going to use sigma of X out of our graphing calculators. Please be aware of that, because it will give you both S of X and sigma of X when you do your one bar stats. So again, we had measures of center are range, max minus min. We have IQR, which is Q3 minus Q1. We're going to break that down a little bit farther today and show you actually how to find those Q1 and Q3 values. And then we have standard deviation. Only a good measure of spread when your histogram or stem plot has a bell-shaped curve to it, or later we'll refer to that as will really define what that means to be normal. But for right now, unimodal, symmetric distribution would be the only time you should really be talking about standard deviation later on after we really get into some real statistics problems and not just building up the bones of the book. Great. When you look at a smoothed over distribution curve, this would be traced over some type of histogram. I don't want to mark up this diagram, but if there was like a histogram behind here, and I kind of just squinted and drew a smooth line over it, that distribution curve. If I were to draw that perfectly, another representation of standard deviation, this will be revisited later when we talk about normality, but just so you hear it more than once, when you look at a perfect bell-shaped curve, the horizontal distance from the mean, which will be the center because it is a bell-shaped symmetric curve, the horizontal distance between the mean of that bell curve and the inflection point where the curve stops curving down and starts to curve back up, that horizontal distance will represent, if done, you know, with a computer or in a textbook, will represent the standard deviation value. So if this were on a number line, well, let's put one here just quickly anyway. Let's say that this is a mean of 10, and tick mark here, tick mark here, tick mark here, 1, 2, 3. I'll explain why I'm doing 3 tick marks later when we do something called the empirical rule. Let's say that this is 13, 16, 19, 7, 4, and 1. And the graph tapers on, and it could potentially go on forever, but this horizontal distance between the center, the average of 10, and this inflection point, which I've now put over 13, would represent that for this bell curve, the standard deviation of visual inspection would be about 3 units. So that's a quick overview of standard deviation. Again, we will revisit this, use the formula, and do some actual examples, and talk about other concepts and properties of standard deviation in a later video. Let's move on to outliers. We talked about describing shapes of distributions, and again, when you're describing shape, it is shape, center, spread, and outliers. I'm kind of pausing to sort of count how many minutes I have left to keep talking for this little video. So we have outliers. Now an outlier is just simply an outlier is just simply a point that falls far outside. I talked about, well, I'd actually need to write this. A outlier is just simply a point that falls outside the overall pattern of data. So if you're looking at a graph and it's got a nice smooth curve, whether it's left skewed, right skewed, or symmetric, and all of a sudden way over somewhere there's like a random point just sort of floating around out in the middle of nowhere by itself, you know, it falls outside the pattern that you're looking at, so that's an outlier. Another way of finding an outlier, if you have univariate data, like maybe we're only measuring test scores like the other day, or shoe sizes, or heart rate per minute, you know, you're only looking at one variable, is the Iqr test. The Iqr test consists of 3 steps. First, finding the Iqr, the interquartile range, the spread of the middle 50% of the data. Q3 is the 75th percentile of data. You've gone to where 75% of the data is less than that value. Q1 is the first quartile. We'll find these again when we look at box plots and again in a later video. So Q3 minus Q1 is the IQR, the spread of the middle 50%. This becomes up to a number. It's like 10 or 20 or 30. We are going to take that IQR value, we are going to multiply it by 1.5 and add it to Q3. That's going to be an upper bound. For a lower bound, it's going to be Q1 minus 1.5 times the IQR, and that's going to be the lower bound. If we have data points that fall outside of this upper and lower boundary, it'll be marked as a possible outlier, but a visual inspection, if possible, is your best way of identifying outliers, because it's easily, you can easily see if a number falls outside of an overall pattern. And data outside these limits are marked as possible outliers. You cannot toss out an outlier just because it looks funny or doesn't seem to make any sense. Let's come up with a very, very simple example to try and identify some outliers. So we're going to make this extremely easy because of time allotment, and I know we're going to be looking at these finding medians and IQRs and Q1s and Q3s later more in depth. So, but let's make up a simple example. So we got some numbers of, 1, 31, 32, 33, well, okay, these are all too similar. 1, 31, 35, 36, 40, and 45, and 49. Okay, so we're going to find the IQ, we're going to do an IQR test on this data. But for IQR tests, we have to know Q1 and Q3. Let's go ahead and find those now with this really simple example. We will revisit this later as we go through the book. How do you find Q1, Q3, and just basically the five-number summary? Well, we got some numbers, and we're going to find the median first, the middle value. Well, they're already listed low to high, so the middle number is 36, and this would be my median. Q1, then, I would take for Q1, I take the first half of my data and find the median again. Well, my first half of my data is only three values, because I did make a very simple example. That's Q1. And then the right side of my data, I'll find the median again the middle number. And since I made just a small example, I can just see without looking that Q3 is going to be 45. Let's try and walk through quickly the IQR test before my 15 minutes are up. Okay, so I have got Q3, which is 45, minus Q1, which is 31, gives me a difference of 14. Now, I'm going to take Q3, which is 45, add it with 1.5 times my IQR of 14. Well, half of 14 is 7, so 45 and 21 is 45, 65, 66. And then I'm going to do Q1, which is 31, minus 1.5 times the IQR of 14. Again, that's 21, so 31 minus 21 is 10. Okay, so now I have my upper limit and my lower limit. Any data that falls outside that range will be marked as a possible outlier. Well, clearly I've made an obvious outlier of 1, and any data outside that range will be marked as a possible outlier. So a very small, simplified example, hopefully not too simple, of finding Q1, Q3, and median. You find median first and then the quartiles, and then the actual steps of finding the IQR test. So because the value of 1 is outside that range, that lower and upper limit, it's going to be marked as an outlier. Or, as I like to emphasize to my students, a possible outlier. Visual inspection is always best. So, a couple more concepts about analyzing the shape of statistical graphs. See you in a minute. Bam!